Okay, good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio on this occasion is social justice. A reminder that if members wish to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. There's quite a bit of interest in supplementaries, so the usual appeal for questions not to come in four parts with a long preamble and for responses to be similarly brief. And I call question number one, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to address child poverty across Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Eradicating child poverty in Scotland is the First Minister's and this Government's top priority. We are providing a range of support to families, including our game-changing Scottish Child Payment, which statistics published this week show was benefiting over 329,000 children by the end of March. Also funded childcare, free bus travel for under-22s and free school meals for over 277,000 children. Modelling published in February estimates that our policies will keep 100,000 children out of relative poverty in 24-25, and I will provide an update on the progress made to tackle child poverty to Parliament on the 4th of June.
Gillian Mackay.
I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. With around a quarter of children in Falkirk in my central Scotland region living in poverty, according to the most recent statistics published, what steps are the Scottish Government taking specifically to ensure that their take-up strategy for social security benefits is maximised and that automatic access to benefits is advanced?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for her question? Gillian Mackay is quite right to point out about the importance of automation, and I was pleased also to see in the statistics for the Scottish Child Payment that it also demonstrated the automated payments that are now being made for the Best Start grants, for example. These obviously came in before the Scottish Child Payment was in place, and what we've now done is been able to bring aspects of the application forms and the payments to be automated to ensure that people can get what they're entitled to. And that's something which I'm determined to see what more we can do over the years ahead.
Couple of supplementaries. First, Bob Doris.
Presiding Officer, last week Professor Danny Dorling told the Social Justice Committee that Europe is paying close attention to the Scottish Child Payment as an example on how policy can radically reduce child poverty levels. Given how Barnett consequentials work, would the Cabinet Secretary encourage the UK Government to do likewise, taking an evidence-based approach to tackling child poverty and remove the many barriers that impact from Westminster to tackle child poverty?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Bob Doris for bringing to my attention Professor Dorling's remarks. I had the pleasure of meeting Professor Dorling when I was down in London a few months ago and found that a very insightful meeting. The member's quite right to point to the fact that the Scottish Child Payment is, of course, only available in Scotland. And if UK Government, of whatever persuasion, was to follow our lead and ensure that they are having universal credit and a welfare system that actually meets people's essentials needs, which is why we've asked for an essentials guarantee to be introduced at a UK level. Some of the changes that could be made in that would, of course, allow the Scottish Government to receive Barnett consequentials on this matter and think what more this Parliament could do if we were funded effectively to again eradicate child poverty.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One-parent families in Scotland found that 39% of children in single-parent families live in poverty, but the 1,140 hours of free childcare does not deliver sufficient provisions to enable single parents to work, as it only covers the school day. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what steps the Scottish Government is taking to ensure that 1,140 childcare hours are delivered more flexibly to meet families' needs, particularly single mothers?
Cabinet Secretary.
I had a very interesting discussion with One Parent Family Scotland on this and on other matters when I met them recently. What I would point out to Faisal Chowdhury is this Government is exceptionally proud of our record on delivering childcare. We have seen since the SNP came to power a doubling of the hours that are available on free childcare. Clearly under the system that we have, it's up to local authorities to ensure that there is flexibility there to be able to meet the needs of the public in their area, and I'm sure the member would wish to take this up with City of Edinburgh Council, as I'm presuming that is the area in question, but certainly with the councils involved to ensure that they are delivering for everybody, including single parents.
Question two, Eleanor Whittam.
To ask the Scottish Government what funding it provided to East and South Ayrshire councils in 2023-24 for discretionary housing payments.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The Scottish Government provided over £2.6 million to East Ayrshire Council for discretionary housing payments in 23-24, supporting over 3,400 households. South Ayrshire Council received over £1.7 million, supporting over 2,000 households. In 24-25, the Scottish Government has increased the total discretionary housing payment budget by £6.8 million. The extra money provided by the Scottish Government through discretionary housing payments is just one of the actions we are taking to help households across the country through the cost of living crisis.
Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Minister for his answer. Statistics released this week show that over 135,000 awards were delivered across Scotland for discretionary housing payments in 23-24, with over 4,000 in East Ayrshire and over 3,300 of them in South Ayrshire. As our main tool for mitigating harmful UK government welfare policies like the bedroom tax, can the Minister comment on the importance of discretionary housing payments as a means to prevent vulnerable households being driven into homelessness in Scotland, and how can we promote their uptake?
Minister.
Yeah, discretionary housing payments are a vital tool in reducing poverty, safeguarding tenancies and preventing homelessness. That's why we've invested over £613 million since 2017. Discretionary housing payments are just one action we are taking to help households across the country to mitigate against over a decade of austerity from Westminster governments. We are investing around £3 billion a year in policies which protect people as far as possible in the cost of living crisis, including an extra £6.8 million in the budget for discretionary housing payments in 24-25 to directly mitigate punitive policies such as the bedroom tax.
Question number three, Paul O'Kane, who joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to address food poverty in light of the recent figures published by the Trussell Trust, showing that its network distributed 262,400 emergency food parcels in the last 12 months.
Cabinet Secretary.
It is not acceptable for anyone to have to rely on emergency food parcels. I visited the Courtyard Pantry enterprise in Glasgow this week, where I saw firsthand how trusted community organisations can support families to access healthy, affordable foods and refer them to financial services. The Scottish Government policy choices have helped to slow the pace of demand for food parcels within Scotland, and Scotland is indeed the only part of the UK not to see an increase in the number of parcels distributed through the Trussell Trust network last year. But we must work with any incoming UK government to urgently fix the issues with universal credit, which is driving food bank use.
Paul O'Kane.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Last year, she published a 9-point plan to end food bank use, but the Trussell Trust stated unequivocally that they were disappointed with the lack of ambition in the plan and that it failed to show the requisite leadership and urgency required. I hear her saying that the Scottish Government would want to work with an incoming government, so I'm sure she'll agree that an incoming Labour government who would prioritise ensuring that work pays and ensuring that we support the stabilisation of the economy so that food prices go down would be very welcome. But I would ask her, how does she respond to those comments by the Trussell Trust? And when is she going to return to her 9-point plan and ensure that it is delivered with the ambition that's required?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm happy to work with any UK government of any persuasion that actually has the best interests of the people of Scotland at its heart. That's why I'm disappointed to note that the Members' Party does not seek to change any of the Tory austerity welfare policies that we have. And given the level of concern from trade unions on some of the employability and fair work measures that may or may not be happening if Labour are elected, let's just say wait to see what happens in reality, Presiding Officer. I think it is very important to point to the fact that the cash first approach which the Scottish Government has developed has been welcomed by many within the anti-poverty charities and organisations, and I was pleased to see how that work has gone to help people, not just to establish more dignity, but also to ensure that we are supporting people out of poverty. And I hope the Member will join me in recognising the Trussell Trust's call for a UK Government to establish an essentials guarantee, something which
the Scottish Government has been calling on for some time. Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and for the applause. Can the Cabinet Secretary comment on Fraser Avallander Institute data showing the significant impact that the Scottish Child Payment has already had on food bank usage in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the latest research does demonstrate the impact of the Scottish Child Payment and the impact it's been having to assist people that are struggling to feed their families. It successfully has reduced food bank usage for specific types of households. The families of more than 329,000 under-16s were benefiting from the Scottish Child Payment at the end of March. But I absolutely do recognise that there is more that we need to do, because any family, any individual that goes to a food bank is a family in crisis, and we should not be there in this day and age, Presiding Officer. That's why we have a social security system that is here to deliver for the people of Scotland. I can only hope at some point we have a UK government with their responsibilities for social security that does the same.
Okay, question 4, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I remind members of my voluntary register of interests to ask the Scottish Government when it anticipates the first payment of employment injury assistance will be made?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government launched a consultation on employment injury assistance on the 30th of April. This consultation, which closes on the 24th of June, will provide vital insights into how employment injury assistance can better meet the needs of disabled people in Scotland in the future, and is an important first step in the longer-term reform of the UK Industrial Injury Scheme in Scotland.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply? 4 years after the devolution of this benefit, the Government has finally launched this consultation paper, in which it admits that there is widespread concern, in which it admits that this has been a low priority. The new First Minister has promised us more concrete actions and fewer strategy documents, and yet here we are with yet another consultation paper. Does the Cabinet Secretary not understand that those former professional footballers with dementia, those firefighters with cancer, those workers across occupations suffering from long COVID, and all those women workers with industrial injury and disease contracted through their work expect more understanding, demand more urgency, and deserve more concrete actions from this government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, the WASPI women deserve urgent action, and the women who required equal pay deserved urgent action. I'm not entirely sure where Richard Leonard was, particularly in Glasgow, when those issues were being discussed. Can I say it's very important that we do develop a system that is done in consultation. That's exactly why we have a system in Scotland for social security that is working effectively. And one of the challenges is successive governments of every colour since the war have led to a UK industrial injury scheme which literally consists of warehouses of paper forms, because the thing is not fit for purpose, nor has it been changed by any government. So I appreciate there is frustration for there to be change. It's just unfortunate they've not seen that under successive UK governments for decades.
And to a couple of brief supplementaries. First, John Mason.
Thank you very much. Based on what the Cabinet Secretary just said, can she confirm that really transferring the current system to Scotland is a major task and has to be the emphasis? And also, can she point out or ask Richard Leonard where the money would come from all the extra benefits he's looking for?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member knows, and I hope many members across the chamber understand, that our position has always been the safe and secure transition of benefits from the United Kingdom government to a system here in Scotland. And that is all done on dignity, fairness and respect. So the member is quite right to point to the fact that we need to ensure that transfer is done safely. Of course, it is exactly why, again, we go back to the point and the urgency of a consultation now being listened to by government, because we do need to take account of the changes that people want to see, something that has seen no changes since it's been introduced in the post-war era. And, of course, cost will be a factor in that. But it is important, it's only one factor. And we do need to look to ensure that we're delivering something that provides dignity, particularly those that have been failed from the system to date.
And Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, the availability of expertise on industrial diseases had been raised as an issue for any potential future Scottish Employment Injury Assistance Advisory Council. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm what scoping has been carried out to date to see if there are enough experts in this field available in Scotland?
Briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member raises a very important practical point that we do need to look at. It's disappointing that the UK government has ensured that we, as in the Scottish Government, cannot ask the current council for advice. So it does mean we do need to look for other ways of doing it, and that's something we'll do through the consultation.
Question 5, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it ensures that disabled people who receive Scottish Social Security benefits are treated lawfully, in light of the Equality and Human Rights Commission's reported investigation into the treatment of some disabled benefits claimants by the UK Department for Work and Pensions.
Cabinet Secretary.
We have very serious concerns over the UK Government's treatment of people applying for disability benefits, so I do welcome this investigation. The Scottish Government has taken relevant public sector equality duties into account throughout the development of disability assistance, and this has been assured through processes of drafting and publishing comprehensive equality impact assessments. The Government is committed to undertaking such assessments with every new policy that impacts on disabled people. Scotland's social security system is designed on the principles of dignity, fairness and respect. Those are the values of this Government and of the people of Scotland.
Rona Mackay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Can you expand on specific measures that are in place to ensure that the assessment processes for Scottish Social Security benefits adhere to those principles of fairness, dignity and respect for disabled claimants, and how these measures differ from those used by the UK Department for Work and Pensions?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I was pleased to hear about the real difference that the new system here in Scotland is making when I was on one of my most recent visits to a Fortitude Community Centre in Motherwell. There I heard directly from people who are carers and also from people who they care from about the difference it makes to, for example, have no private sector assessments as part of the system and to have a system that's been designed with people to ensure that we actually maximise the benefits that they are entitled to, given the fact that social security is a human right. That compassionate approach is in stark contrast to the DWP.
And Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's clear that our social security and benefits ambitions in Scotland have a quite different foundation to those elsewhere on these islands, but we must continue to improve. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me what work has been undertaken to ensure increased and improved understanding of chronic but very variable conditions across our social security system, so that people do not have their needs judged based on their best days, but are instead supported to cope and thrive on their worst days?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Maggie Chapman raises a very important point that was raised by many people when we were designing CDP and ADP, that they felt that the application system and the assessment process really didn't work for people with variable conditions. That's exactly why we went through a consultation process that designed our current system with people with that experience to ensure that the application form and the way the decisions are taken can do the best that we possibly can for those people. Now, clearly the system's still new and we will have more to learn on that, but we're determined to do that.
Thank you. Question 6 has been withdrawn. Question 7, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I wish to apologise to the Chamber for my late arrival. To ask the Scottish Government how its Rural Affordable Homes for Key Workers Fund will help tackle island depopulation.
Minister Paul McLennan.
I recognise the importance of good quality affordable homes to attracting and retaining people in our rural and island communities, including for key workers. We will invest nearly £600 million in affordable homes across Scotland this year, including through the demand-led Rural and Islands Housing Fund and Key Workers Fund, of which 4 affordable homes have already been approved in Orkney. Between 2016-17 and 2022-23, through the wider Affordable Housing Supply Programme, over 10,000 affordable homes have been supported across rural and island areas, of which more than 1,100 have been delivered in island communities.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The lack of workers is the key constraint for many island businesses and public services. This fund is a welcome measure for attracting and retaining people to our island communities. Can the Minister say how flexible the scheme will be, given that organisations such as Arran Development Trust have highlighted issues with accessing the Affordable Housing Supply Programme and the Rural and Islands Housing Fund?
Minister.
Yeah, my officials have recently met with Arran Development Trust to discuss the concerns that have been raised and to encourage collaborative working with North Ayrshire Council to support delivery of high-quality, permanent and affordable homes for key workers where they are required. The £30 million Rural and Islands Housing Fund can also support delivery of high-quality homes, including for attracting or retaining economically active workers in rural areas and community groups such as Arran Development Trust, who are able to access this fund.
A brief supplementaries first, Miles.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I know you will welcome the four homes which have been provided in Orkney, but there's been nothing else across the country for a whole year now. It's clear from what Kenneth Gibson has said that the criteria for this scheme is way too limited. So can I ask the Minister whether or not they will now review that and also look towards the development potentially of a national empty homes fund for island and rural communities as well?
Minister.
Yeah, just to pick up on the 2 points, I think I mentioned about the four homes that have been approved in Orkney. There are discussions ongoing with Western Isles, Eagleland, Bute Fife, Perth and Kinross and obviously North Ayrshire Council at the moment about the projects being delivered. I think the important point is that they have to be delivered strategically. So it's not just individual projects, but how do we deliver that strategically across the area? I think in terms of the points he made about empty homes, I think Scottish Government has spent a number of money, I think it's about £3.5 million in developing 9,000 empty homes now. That's available across the whole of Scotland. So again, happy to pick up any issues he has in the rural communities in that regard. There's also a number of other developments that were going on as well in regards to the work we are doing with, for example, Highland Council around about the Freeport provisions in that area, and also with SSEN in terms of what they're doing about renewable hubs and the key workers accommodation that's required for that, both on a temporary and a permanent accommodation.
And Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interests. When I last raised this with the First Minister in order that housing be provided to allow the Portree Hospital to be open 24/7, he gave me a long list of actions that was taken around the Broadford Hospital, which are laudable but actually does nothing to keep the Portree Hospital open when it's required. Can I ask specifically how the Scottish Government are going to provide key worker housing in Portree?
Minister.
I'm happy to meet Rhoda Grant, first of all, on that particular matter. And I was in the chamber when that was raised. I think one of the key things we talked about the key workers was in about the strategic overview that the local authority has to take, and I think that would be the first port of call in that particular regard. But happy to meet Rhoda Grant to discuss that particular point that she's mentioned, and also people in the area as well, if she needs to do so. So she can contact me after that. Happy to discuss that with her.
Thank you. And question 8, Rachel Hamilton, who joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to update any guidance that it provides regarding the application of single-sex exemptions under the Equality Act 2010 buildings in Scotland.
Minister Kilcab-Stewart.
I thank Rachel Hamilton for that. She will be aware that the Equality Act 2010 is largely reserved. I note that the UK Government has recently issued a call for input, which does extend to Scotland, seeking examples of guidance on single-sex spaces. There are no immediate plans to update any guidance in this area.
Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I'm afraid I have lost sound to the Chamber, but my supplemental to the Minister is women's groups have expressed concerns over the use of gender-neutral toilets and changing places, while a consultation brought forward by the UK Government has found that 81% of respondents agreed with the intention that separate single-sex toilets will be provided in public buildings. Therefore, can I ask the Minister if the Scottish Government plans on mirroring the UK Government in bringing forward requirements for single-sex toilet facilities in non-domestic buildings?
Minister.
Thank you. As the member says, this relates to building regulations in England only, and the Scottish building regulations require all new buildings to provide sanitary facilities for all occupants and visitors to the building. It is the responsibility of Building Warren Application to design proposals to satisfy the building regulations, and those proposals should give appropriate consideration for the provision of male, female and unisex facilities to meet the needs of the building users. Of course, those building regulations do not address the onward use of buildings of those who can and cannot use toilets based on a person's gender or sex.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a point of order, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am very, very supportive of the ability in this chamber to work in a hybrid way, given I am a working mother, but it is the responsibility of everyone taking part to have secure connections. And I am concerned that the Minister has now given answers which the Member couldn't by her own admission here. And I'm wondering what more we can do, Presiding Officer, to make sure people have secure connections so that those that are answering questions to the Government can actually, asking questions of the Government, can actually hear the answer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That's not an unreasonable point. I don't think it's a point of order, but it's not an unreasonable point, and I will reflect further on that. If there's anything to say in the Chamber or in writing to members, I'll ensure that that happens. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.